Ladies and gentlemen, requesting all of you to please take your seats. We're ready to get started. And as you do so, I'd like to remind you to please share your views on how do you think Brand India is growing globally on the We On wall, which is in the pre-function area. So please don't forget to share your views. And of course, sign it for us as well. And keep those tweets coming using our Twitter hashtag PitchCMO. Well, I'm going to move into our panel discussion for the evening, where we're going to discuss interfacing with the connected customer. And first up, I'd like to invite on stage our moderator for the panel, Mr. Vikram Tanna, VP Head Advertising, Sales and Business Head of Regional Clusters, Discovery Communications India. And it's time for me to welcome our esteemed panelists on stage, Mr. Amit Tiwari, VP Marketing, Havells, Mr. Siddharth Banerjee, Executive Vice President, Marketing, Vodafone, and Mr. Bhaskar Chaudhary, Director, Marketing, Lenovo. Ladies and gentlemen, let's have a huge round of applause for our panel, which is going to be a very interesting one.
Good evening, everyone, and a very warm welcome to our session, where we'll be discussing how the consumer, the digitally empowered consumer today, is being worked upon, looking at various aspects, challenges, opportunities. It's my privilege this evening to have a very prestigious set of panel along with me, coming in from diverse backgrounds, from FMCG to telecom, so on and so forth. And it's really going to be a very interesting evening. I promise to make it very interactive. We are not going to follow the regular format here, where we are going to talk a lot and then limited time for question and answers. I would really love the audience to raise their hands in between as the discussion is going on, and we will take answers while the discussions are on specific topics as well. Well, today we are living in an age where the brand definition has changed. The brand definition is largely driven by how customers are giving you reviews, whether they are positive or negative. How are the different experiences panning out? It's really a situation where, you know, consumer is the king, but is miles ahead of where the brand is or what the brand managers want to do. In this challenging environment, there are various aspects of positivity and negativity, and it's a complete polar situation. If you look at it, what is the best form of publicity today? The best form of publicity, I would want to put it, is in the form of word of mouth. We all understand that positive word of mouth travels fantastically well at great speed. But the fact of the matter is, when word of mouth is negative, it travels even faster. And if you ask some social media analytics around, they'll all agree and come up to you and give a measurement matrix saying it's faster than the speed of light. Yes, absolutely, that's true in today's world. And what does it mean for businesses? It's a completely different situation when it comes to tackling such situations. Let's take an example of how industries get affected. If you look at the Bollywood industry or any film industry, until some time back, they used to open on weekends and then start working towards saying, how do I get maximum footfalls through great marketing? How do I get footfalls through showcasing my biggest star cast, which is over there? And then the fact of the matter is, if I cut a great trailer, I'll get people coming in. Time has changed now with social media gathering so many consumers over there. One tweet from the likes of Taran Adarsh or Equivalent or on your WhatsApp groups actually changes the game. You may actually lead to a blast at the box office or completely going down to zero levels almost. In such a situation, it's going to be very, very challenging for brands as well when you start looking out, social listening is happening. The other extreme is it also opens up a world of opportunities. And the oldest case study in this scenario is probably when Gmail entered India and the only internet guy over there was Hotmail. It was a complete monopoly, and this is probably 15 years back. But the fact of the matter is, with just positive consumer experience on the digital platform at that time, they actually could gain and acquire the entire set of customers which were sitting on Hotmail. Zero advertising, just positive consumer response. With that, I would like to kickstart the panel discussion now. And even before we get into the discussion, I would request the panelists to spend 2 to 3 minutes briefly and talking about their consumer experiences, how they are managing conversations in a very, very tough environment. The digitally empowered consumer is actually very vocal. Let me start with you, Amit. You know, you come from a background where you've managed a lot of brands, looked at their digital transformation. We've known each other for a long time. and you come across as a very, very strong advocate for digital transformation. What are your learnings in this space, and how are you managing the consumer in such a tough environment?
Thanks, Vikram. I think if you ask me today, I'm still a learner, and I'm still learning a lot of things day by day, because the way the consumer behavior is changing, not only from the digital standpoint, but also the way the different modes have changed today. If you see, traditionally 2 years back, and not much of time, we used to do a consumer decision journey, let's say by state or by category that we need to look for. Today, within the state, we need to draw between a pattern between Chennai is different from rest of TN, and similar with other particular. It becomes extremely difficult for marketer really to understand and act upon, maybe digital, non-digital, and with all honesty, and I'll tell you, it's still a very hard task to do, because you're learning and you have to improvise your learning and also get into different tangents. Yes, if I see in my previous avatar, in my current and all, we're very proud that we have a digital marketing team and we have 5 people in a team. I think that has changed in a big way. Today you need to have digital factories, and you really, when people talk about micro movements, these micro movements can only actually get when you have micro specialization of people. So in my team, when I actually look for digital transformation, I have a guy who only look for content. And this is not a video content, it's only what is the textual content that needs to go for a brand. What should be the brand tonality from a content standpoint? There's a guy who only looks for programmatic and performance, because that's the specialization you need to capture, and that too by regional markets that you need to. You can't have one particular standing strategy that works. So this is my strategy, I will do geo-targeting, that will be fine for me to look for. So specialization, micro-specialization for micro-moments, and getting into vernacular and cutting vernacular within the same state is what is I am looking, and that's what I think.
Very interesting. Horses for courses, isn't it? I'll come to you, Sid, now. Sid heads marketing for Vodafone. He's got a very enriching experience in the FMCG sector. And Sid, you've worked across markets, including the UK and Singapore as well. What is your mantra of, you know, if I have to put it in a line, how do you win the digital audience, or how do you influence and win the digital audience? Is there a formula? Can you share that secret formula that you've been practicing?
I wish there was a formula, but let me start with saying a thank you on my own personal behalf to Sanjay for a fabulous, fabulous peek into, on behalf of the audience, and some of you came and spoke to me about how brilliant and eye-opening that was. So thank you for a lot of provocations in your talk this evening. But if I were to build on some of the thoughts, because I resonated deeply with what Sanjay spoke about, and if I were to build on some of my own learnings across CPG and now telecom, I think, in the spirit of 3 P's, just to make it into a mantra, like you said, maybe I'd like to talk about the 3 P's in terms of the first being paranoia. So when Sanjay spoke about the fact that while your brand might be doing well and the metrics are looking very, very good, do you really have a sense on the zoom out perspective of what could be potentially disrupting you, not 5, 10 or 20 years down the line, but potentially even in 12 months or a couple of quarters down the line? So the first piece is literally about me as a business leader, me as someone who is responsible for looking at what's happening in the consumer sphere, feeling paranoid and therefore constantly being open to learning, going out, checking with consumers what's happening, what are others doing in the field, having conversations with people who understand the space, etc. So the first P in that sense is about paranoia, which leads to inquiry, which leads to, I think like Amit said, continuous learning. The second P, as it were, if there were ever to be a mantra, is about a little bit of peace, or a moment of clarity, or a moment of calm. Yes, the world has become digital. But you know what? Some of the things, some of the fundamentals are still the same. Basic common sense still applies. The power of insights still applies. And while, of course, we talk about very fashionably about the D word, if we can just kind of take a pause, a moment of calm, and therefore peace, the P of peace, and say that most amount of the disproportionate amount of time and energy needs to be spent back with the same guys who you were spending many, many years ago, which is the customers and the consumers, and spending more time with them and mining and uncovering insights. Some physically, and of course, some through social listening, mining, with the use of advanced analytics, and big data. So that's really the second P, the P of peace in that sense. And the third P, which I again resonate very strongly because, both in my previous avatar at Unilever and now with Vodafone, the P of partnerships and unusual partnerships, as Sanjay called it, I think is extremely critical to building an ecosystem which can serve to be both a competitive advantage as well as a great source of learning. So today, I'm very cognizant of the fact that most of the best ideas are happening somewhere else. A lot of innovation is happening outside of the organization. And can I look at harnessing all of that through a couple of structured interventions? So some of us, the bigger advertisers, do this thing called Content Day. Vodafone has taken it one step further, and we are calling it Contech, which is the confluence of content and technology, and borrowing from all the people in the world, whether it is the boutique agencies, whether it is startups, whether it is production houses, whether it is these youngsters sitting in tier two towns, but with fantastic stories. And so therefore, that's the third P, which is the power of partnerships. So really, these three Ps, if there were ever a mantra.
Thanks for sharing those wonderful insights, Sid. I really love the P for peace. And this era where we are all trying into, find more peace by doing digital detox. Can we have a quick vote over here to see that how many of you all feel digital detox is important and that helps it also to catch people when people are not online? Hands up for people who want to go with digital detox at some point of time. Well, it's like the herd mentality. I see three hands and then more and more, like, people are really feeling that each other should share the digital detox scenario. So more time for yoga for everyone, for sure. Coming to you, Bhaskar, Bhaskar heads marketing for the Lenovo Group, and he's been instrumental in actually creating a lot of categories within Lenovo, including smartphones, tabs, etc. He's also, on the other side, been extensively working on the FMCG piece. He comes from a very strong FMCG background where, Bhaskar, I think on Cadbury Dairy Milk, we've all heard in the industry, you had a great dream run, breaking all kinds of sales records when you were there in that stint. How do you actually see the reaction or the consumer behavior of an individual who is empowered digitally, which is the digital audience, which is a TV viewer, and what are the brand strategies that you would go for each of these? Are they same? Is there an overlap? Is it completely different?
So quickly, a bit of from my experience, because I come from an FMCG background, and we were working, let's say, around 2007, 2008, where digital was the brave thing to do, was the unique thing to do. And unfortunately, I think over a period of time, with a few exceptions, it remains a bit of nice thing to do for bulk of the FMCG industry. And I suddenly catapulted into something, because I am a ignoramus when it comes to technology. I don't follow technology very strongly when I moved to Lenovo, where actually digital, or certainly e-commerce, became a marketplace. So it was not a nice thing to do. It was something that you had to do to sell your products. For example, when I joined, within a couple of years, a majority of our smartphones, majority means more than 50%, was getting sold through e-com and not through physical stores. Even now, almost 20 to 25% of our PCs actually get sold through e-commerce and not through physical stores. So it was no longer an indulgence or a hobby or a passion that one had to pursue, but an urgent amount of adult learning that I had to do once I moved to Lenovo. Two things that I want to talk about, at least on a consumer change that we see. Previously, we used to have this view of the consumer that he starts from his behavior is like a funnel. When he starts his search or when he expresses interest in buying a particular category, he looks through an array of brands, then he narrows down further, finally he chooses one brand. What digital does in a consumer decision journey, as Amit was saying, is actually you might be, and you can look up and reflect on your behavior when you buy certainly any electronic item, because I have studied it a bit and I can speak about it. He actually starts with two or three brands. But as a process of research, or when he is in the middle of the funnel, actually his brand choices expand. So it almost becomes like a barrel. It's no longer the conventional funnel. So what digital is doing is expanding that part of the consumer decision journey from pre-purchase or from intention to purchase in a very significant manner. Now we study it because, as I was saying, e-com forms a significant part of our business. And what we find is, interestingly for India, Indian consumers spend a disproportionate time on research as compared to anywhere else in the world. So they spend 50% of their pre-purchase time in researching brands. And it starts from pre-awareness, awareness to intention to research to final purchase. And then post-purchase and word of mouth recommendation after sales service comes after that. But research occupies 50% of its time in this whole journey. Worldwide, the average would be somewhere in the mid-30s. What it tells you is, one is the innate need to know more about the product, certainly when it comes to technology. And as Sanjay was talking about it, when he was talking about apparel, if you go to colleges now, the hot guy or the more knowledgeable guy is the one who is the tech geek. When we were growing up, it was a guy with a fancy bike or the fancy pair of jeans. But that's the change which has happened, and that's getting reflected in the consumer education journey in this manner. What it means to a marketer to quickly come back is not get swayed with the second point that Siddharth was making. Some of the fundamentals remain the same. And I'm talking in a media forum. For a media seller, it's very well to talk about media affinity in terms of time spent by consumer in each type of media. But as a marketer, media affinity should not immediately lead me to divvying up my money in that sense across media. Because what we are discovering is while a disproportionate amount of time is being spent on digital, actually TV remains far more effective. And that's another bane of our times, because we mistake measurement for effectiveness. Digital is something that we measure, and hence we make the mistake that it must be the most effective. And we quickly draw this conclusion that TV we can't measure, so obviously it's not being as effective. But more and more number of mixed modeling or analytics studies are actually telling us that TV remains a far more effective choice in terms of driving brand upsell or skew in sales than digital does. And that's a big learning that is coming for us, because to find the role of media in which part of the decision journey is the key thing. So at the pre-awareness stage, where traditionally marketers spend the most amount of time and money in terms of spending media dollars, TV or some of the mass media still remain the more effective media. And actually during the research process, when you're looking at influencers, when you're looking at reviews, when you're looking at fellow customer comments, then digital starts playing a bigger role. And that's been a bit of a paradigm change. And that I think is what was the slightly subtle part about Mark Pritchard's comments last week when he said that PNG is cutting down on digital, while he talked about ad fraud, et cetera, et cetera. I think he also made a comment about effectiveness. And I belong to the same community, but more and more marketers are engineers. I think we are just getting too thrilled by the measurement and the effectiveness part of it. And as a result, we are really sacrificing creativity at the altar. So that's.
Thank you for those wonderful insights, Bhaskar. I think really the new definition of TV or the full form of TV, you know, as one of the individuals whom I was interviewing the other day, where I was trying to see, you know, what is his expertise? Is it television or digital? Because we wanted to hire somebody who's like the best of both the worlds. You know, this kid actually came and told me, you know, don't ask me TV and digital. TV is actually total video, right? Be it digital, be it television. And that's where the world is moving, actually. Coming to you, Amit, you know, you've done some path-breaking campaigns at Havells. You've been the brainchild of working around a lot of creative stuff and breaking those norms of what a normal creative would do, specifically your Hawa Badlegi kind of ad, where you've taken different social causes, be it women empowerment, be it religious conversion, so on and so much. It's a very, very powerful message. Now, once you crack that creative and you want to put it up in that digital world, it's full of challenges, isn't it? Because you've got a brand safety bucket where you have to land and you just can't go there. So very easy thing to do is buy programmatic. But what do you do with that programmatic? You don't know what kind of content it is. So how do you manage campaigns and how does your brand overcome these challenges?
Sure, Vikram. Before I get into the question, Vikram, you asked, I just want to make a small point which Bhaskar was mentioning. And I completely agree what Sid mentioned, which Bhaskar didn't agree on it. But your principles remains and practices changes. Your principles of marketing doesn't change, but whatever you want to do it. And I think I completely agree what Sid. My only difference, which I see what Bhaskar just mentioned is, see, today the fight is not about TV or mobile or digital. Today we are in a wage, and there was an IDC report which published last week only, 72% of the Indian audience do multi-screening together. So the fight is not about whether you are digital, whatever you are doing, end of the day, you are being consumed or you are being caught by XYZ brand. So I think that phenomenon of fighting against TV, not TV or mobile, I think it's still debatable, depending upon how we can actually look for. Coming to the point you mentioned about, yes, lot of social grounds have been taken, and yes, in today's point, when we draw, as I mentioned in my previous question which you asked me about, consumer decision journey is one part of it, but you also have to parallelly draw consumer digital journey. What is the consumption pattern, what's the content consumption pattern happens across the geographies that you look for? Taking the example you talked about, Hawa Badlegi is a fantastic proposition. You talk about Hindi SMS speaking markets. The moment you go to regional, Hawa Badlegi has no connotation at all. So you have to coin something which is relevant to those markets. Today, if you see most of the brands in the category, we operate on almost 27 categories today. And most of the sales come from tier 2 and tier 3 markets, where the market potential lies. So you have to coin campaigns. You have to reach to those. There may be a campaign which is only devised for radio, and people are consuming that radio through digital. You can actually go to those particular mediums, and you have to see what is the content that these guys are consuming. We have gone to the level of creating, not only doing a typical translation, but transliteration of a lot of things that can actually make a regional meaning, and that can not only run again on digital, but also on other platforms to work. So that is what we are trying to consciously choosing and making those choices, so that we don't lose out in terms of just by sitting in our offices in Delhi and Gurgaon and deciding only that this is what is the consumption pattern that will follow in these regional markets, which is the hardcore of the business for us.
Very interesting. Sid, coming on to you, you know, technology at its forefront is responsible for changing consumer behavior, and this kind of helps you to get the brand closer to the consumer as well. However, the fact of the matter is, I'm sure everybody in the room agrees that while technology helps you understand the consumer better, it has to be beyond transactional, right? Building those relationships is very, very important. And when we start looking at how do you gauge experiences of this consumer who's digitally empowered in that whole environment, specifically, it's a very, very tough category, telecom, when I look at it. How do you manage consumer experiences? For example, you know, I'm sure there are a lot of people in this room who would have this common dialogue, and I see people in offices or buildings talking about it. You know, two people are talking to each other, and you've got a huge SOV flowing in saying, I have my 4G campaign going in. The common thing is, hey, what's happening? You know, there's a call drop. Agar yehi nahi ho raha hai, toh 4G kaise hoga? And you're promising 4G. How many people have these normal conversations of saying call drop hote rehta hai? Do you guys require a lot of, yeah, lots of them, Sid, yeah, including yourself. Fantastic. Very, very nice of you to be honest. But how do you tackle this challenge? As a marketer, you are shouting out about 4G. I'm going in as a consumer, whether it's you or any other telecom operator. How do you do this? It's the toughest environment for anybody in the entire category.
So firstly, thank you for sympathizing with the hot job that I kind of sit with. Nice of you to do that. I think the hallmark of any brand in any category is authenticity, okay? And consumers love and respect authenticity. Ultimately, what is a brand? It's a human relationship. And just like in human relationships, we respect authenticity, we value authenticity, the same is true for brand relationships as well. So that's the first point. The other point that you made about telecom is that whether it's Vodafone or any of our competing brands, telecom is an example of an intense category. So in my previous avatar, you would use a soap or a soup a certain number of times in a month or in a week, depending upon a personal care category versus a home care category. Mobile telephony is an intense category because it's 24/7, 365. Yeah, and you do expect a level of performance to be consistent every time, all the time, 365, 24/7. Now, therefore, the intent of a marketer remains that we want to offer the experience, which of course consumers value, which of course we build on what we can deliver. So if we are rolling out 4G services across the country, of course we will talk about 4G services because that's the need of what consumers want. They want faster data speeds, faster downloads, so on and so forth. And at the same time, we will be improving our services. We will be continuously improving our, like you said, connectivity, etc., while keeping very close track on the metrics. I think if we get it right, 99.5% or whatever is the metric as reported by some of the regulatory bodies on a monthly basis, if we get it right most of the time, and we have the humility, and that is literally the bedrock of the happy to help philosophy that Vodafone has for many, many years, if we have the humility to say, okay, we could not kind of satisfy and live up to the customer expectation at a certain piece of point in time, and try and solve for that, then I think consumers love us for that. So I have an interesting anecdote about a certain piece of communication which was made much, much before my time, but I'm sure people in the room identify with the pug communication that we have, which was basically this cute little dog following a little boy everywhere across Goa. And this was many, many years ago, but I'm sure if I were to take a, you know, poll of hands, people would remember it. And the promise was the network that follows. Yeah. And if you were to reflect back on that piece of communication, there is a certain time that the pug is climbing the steps and the pug slips a little bit and then the pug climbs back. Consumers decoded it when we went and met consumers in normal immersions that we have. Consumers decoded it as saying, "Haan, aapka network bhi kabhi kabhi gir jata hai, jaise aapka pug thoda slip kar jata hai, but theek hai, aap basically aap hame achha service dete ho, wo galti maaf." So as long as you are authentic, as long as you are living up to your standards, which consumers love you for, you are more likely than not to get it right. So I think the bedrock is authenticity. It is about recognizing if there is a problem, are you solving for it? So every time we could put up some great communication, and Vodafone has had a history of fabulous communication over the years, every time we put up some great new ad, some of the contents, some of the comments that will regularly come on social media platforms, ki ye sab to theek hai, lekin aap apne network kya kya kar rahe hain? Of course, we are investing time, effort, money, because that's really the day job of the company, to provide better connectivity layer to our consumers, but we try and live up to that promise on a daily basis. But that's the challenge of running an intense brand.
Yeah, absolutely tough job, but I think you make it sound very, very simple. Keep it simple is probably your mantra. Coming on to you, Bhaskar, you know, you kind of mentioned that your brand is very, very active on e-commerce, and that makes it very, very important for you to kind of say that, okay, the entire sales cycle, the entire AIDA model kind of works on the digital platform, which means you have your customers exploring, comparing prices, features, shopping, and completing the transaction there, which is very, very important for you as a marketer to say that, should I continuously develop social listening tools for me to enable how the consumer is moving across stages? And then you've been doing this campaign, I've been following it personally, the Lenovo service live for a while, which is extremely challenging because you are going to the battleground. Like, social media is a huge battleground because you have to be ready for all positive and negative communication coming live. And you guys have gone straight to the battlefield and got a few guys like gamers, etc., which have a good following, talking to your consumers. But at the same time, senior management going live and facing the heat, including yourself, for half an hour. How was it? Can you share your experiences with us?
I think services live goes back to the point that I was making, and I don't think I explained it very well, which is to say that we have to understand the role of media at which stage of the journey that the consumer is, and apply the role of media there. Media is a dependent variable. Media, we shouldn't start treating it as an independent variable like we are looking at digital nowadays. Now, when we come to services, again, going back to the role of media, I don't know how many of you would agree, but the best media for services reputation, leave alone ATL, leave alone everything else, is word of mouth. And the authenticity of a service reputation is actually delivered far better on a word of mouth basis than through any other different types of media. As it so happens in today's time, that word of mouth is communicated most vociferously and most honestly, maybe sometimes too acidly on social media. And therefore, the call that we took, because we made there was a time that we were really languishing on our service reputation, and we made huge changes. But we said that if we have to communicate it rather than look at any other media, let's get into where the conversation is the warmest or the hottest, and then talk about it if we really believe that we've made a change. And let us or the leadership team of the company face people on a live basis, because it's as bad as it can get. Because in social media, and I think all of you are there on Twitter, etc., people don't hold back any punches. If at all, they wear knuckle dusters when they come onto social media. So let's put it up. And in a restaurant analogy, let's open the doors of the kitchen and let people see what's behind the doors and let them comment as to what we are doing. Therefore, we tried to do that on services live. We got our fair share of brickbats, but I think it made us far more honest. The if you look at it from a net promoter score sense, we actually got more love than hatred, even during the campaign days. And I think it's a great way of communicating if you really believe that your service has improved. On the worst place to actually talk about service, because most brands actually shy away from talking about service or take away the comments elsewhere when you go on to social and complain about it.
Yeah, I think we're running a little bit short on time. One last question from my end to Amit. Sorry. Yeah, please go ahead. Can somebody help him with the mic, please?
Yeah, hi.
If you can just quickly introduce yourself, sir.
Yeah, I'm PM Balakrishna. I am the Vice President for the Hindu Group. Surprisingly, we are a print media sponsoring a digital panel discussion. So it shows we also believe in digital media a lot. I just wanted to ask you on this word of mouth, which is the probably biggest brand endorsement that can happen. But in the digital scenario, you know, where is the ethics, given the fact that word of mouth is so easily bought and actually traded, you know, with such ease? Where is the brand see, and how is that valuation happen? And how does one, you know, given the fact, as some of you started by saying, Bhaskar, yourself, that you don't understand technology, and a mass part of the audiences that you're dealing with really don't understand technology and how the web and the internet can massage, you know, communication to make it look like actually it's a fact. How does this ethics of the word of mouth be handled by all of you?
It's for Bhaskar. You want to direct it to any?
Yeah, because he spoke about word of mouth being the.
Yeah, sure, Bhaskar.
I think, honestly speaking, the scenario is a bit grim, and you see what Facebook is attempting to do by killing off news feeds, what Twitter has attempted to do in the wake of certain political campaigns is trying to clean it up. As a consumer, I still believe what my friends, family, and people I am connected with one degree of separation, far higher than what I am receiving on second degree and third degree. That's one point and one encouraging signal for us. The second thing that you're doing is, or you're seeing increasingly in the West, is this whole influencer celebrity culture is also diminishing. So people who used to post things on Instagram, etc., taking anywhere between hundreds to millions of dollars for a single post, Nimar actually takes something in six figures for each post of his, is also getting diminished. So I think authenticity, like Sid said, will come back to the forefront if you're just trying to be a trick pony for a particular brand. And certainly in the case of word of mouth, when it comes to service reputation, I would be far more liable to believe somebody who has experienced it and who is in my immediate circle than any celebrity talking about it. So I think that's still heartening and comforting for us.
Thanks, Bhaskar. Any more questions? If you all can raise your hands. Yeah, if you can just pass the mic to that gentleman there. If you could quickly introduce yourself before shooting the question, and
Hi.
Whom do you want to address the question to, please?
My name is Pritam. Question for Amit. So I know that you have multiple brands across sectors. So how do you handle these different multiple brands when you talk to the customers on digital and also at trade level?
Okay, so we have one master brand strategy, which is Havells as a master brand strategy. Then we have three power brands, which is Lloyd, Standard, and Crabtree. And the audience are very different across all the market, the geographies, and also the products that we actually offer. So for example, if I'm actually offering, let's say, a very premium high-end automation, which is only in the portfolio of Crabtree, which is not in the portfolio of a normal Havel switch, which I actually make. So for a normal Havel switch, which is a 20 rupees product, whereas an automation product, which is a 30,000 product, the audiences changes, and also the profile of the customer who I'm targeting geography-wise, as also the market-wise, it actually changes.
Okay. Yep. Any other questions, please? Raise your hands. Okay, one question for my end, before we kind of do it, and direct it to any one of you guys. You know, there is this whole hype in the market. At some time, we've actually seen a lot of peer brand pressure saying, I'm on digital, how much do you spend, right? How many of y'all would want to put your hands up saying this is the truth? Is there peer brand pressure saying how much are you spending on digital and you should increase your spends, yes or no? Hands up for no. Only a few hands up for no. The rest of them are playing with their better half, which is the mobile. Everybody's connected right now, right? So specifically, you know, in this age, when we are talking about how technology is moving, how brand pressure is probably there, not there for individuals, there is this whole new hype coming up now, which is talking about AI, AR, VR. As marketers, Amit, coming to you, and then would love your views, Sid and Bhaskar as well, briefly. We've got 3-4 minutes left. How do you see this coming up? Is there any pressure right now to get into this? Are you guys doing generally? Do it seed for the classes, masses? How do you look at it as a brand?
See, Vikram, I don't see there's a pressure today which talks about that you really need to spend. I think everybody is smart enough to understand what you're doing for pressure and what you're actually doing, because digital is not something which is very, very, very less in terms of investment that you look for. But if you see the reality today, and one of these surveys I was just laying my hand some time back is, in 2018, which is sitting in this year, 25% of your content is written by bots. The amount of investment that companies are doing to actually have an interface with bots, which itself says that, yes, there's an investment that is required. Do you really want to bombard your investment in some showing this is what the clicks and this is what the CTRs I want to acquire? I think the days have gone for it. You have to be more than smart. You have to be affinated to your particular audiences, whether it is actually relevant. You need to have those answers. If that answers are right, I think no medium irrespective is something that you need to do for a pressure that needs it. Anything else that you want to add?
Sid, you've got your campaign saying future is exciting. You are inviting the consumers to a whole new digital era and getting them to sample new ways. Just quickly in the last 1 minute or so, if you could give your views on that one. Is it just campaign led or is it beyond the hype in reality?
So I think digital is not a constant. It's a dynamic investment for us. There were two parts of digital that we spoke about. One is multi-screening, and therefore consumers seeing us on different screens, so certain amount of reach and frequency, especially for TV light audiences. And that's a function of the dynamics between the screens and their costings and the reach frequency curves that they give us. So digital needs to earn its right to play in that sense. The second bit on digital is what it enables us to do in terms of hard-hitting performance, which is in terms of our offers, tariffs, recharges, etc., very directly attributable to the ultimate revenue objective. So if it keeps rising, we will invest more. If it does not, we see some plateauing, we will not. So it's a dynamic variable and not a certain percentage that has peer pressure built in, is the short answer. The second part of your question is about technology. As a technology company, I think it is inherent for us first to play a lot with technology, which is why you might have seen Vodafone more in the recent times playing a lot, whether it is with drones, and some of our films being shot with that, some of our activations happening with that, or be it the recent augmented reality piece that we did with our pug invading the center court at the finals of the Premier Badminton League in Hyderabad, where animals were not allowed in the center court, and yet we have a lovable brand icon, which is the pug. So about 40 million viewers saw on their televisions these lovable pugs invading the center court at the finals, because we managed it through augmented reality. So I think it's a build of our capabilities to express ourselves in a world where consumers see so much of digital magic happening on them, which is not related to the question of budgets, but more related to us beefing up our digital muscle and our ability to communicate effectively with consumers in a digital world.
Thanks, Sid. We're running short of
time. Excuse me. Hi. Yeah. Hi. This is just one question, please. Hi, this is Kiran Srivastava from Molecule Communications. My question is to Siddharth. Siddharth, what if a competitive brand picks up some loopholes and uses that in their campaign? What is your reaction to that? Is it solving those loopholes and coming up with new campaigns because digital is really fast? Or would you figure out their loopholes and come up with a competitive campaign? What is your approach at that time?
I'm ruthlessly focused on my consumer.
Okay, sorry, I didn't get it.
He's focused. He says he's focused on what he's doing and doesn't get distracted with anything which people are doing.
Okay, thanks.
And he's going back to his three P's. Well said,
thanks.
I'm afraid we are running short of time. Thank you so much for joining us for this session. Thank you so much, panelists, for sharing your wonderful insights.
Thank you very much to our panelists and our moderator. I'd like to request Mr. PM Balakrishna, VP the Hindu Group, to kindly join us on stage.
So I think it was really an illuminating discussion, and you know, like I said, we are from the print media. But having said that, I think it's a point well made that in today's world of digital growth, none of the brands, whether it is you know, any one of us here, can afford to ignore this very important medium. And I think liked what he said about paranoia, peace, and partnerships. I think these are mantras which are media agnostic. This is important for all of us as brands. But we in the print media, I think, have started understanding the whole dynamics. And truly, from the Hindu, I can tell you that we are now become a lot more integrated from a media perspective. And today, when we are obsessed, which is why the word of mouth question and the credibility of the word of mouth, we are very obsessed with our readers, you know, and that is an obsession that we have carried into the digital business also. So today we are really innovating from our website and our apps and so on and so forth. That's where the brand is going. And I see all of us, you know, traversing this journey together, and with such exciting times ahead, you know, I think there's a lot to do. So thank you so much for all the views that each one of you gave. And I think, I'm sure from an audience perspective, a loud hand for all of them, please. Yeah. So from the Hindu, we'd like to thank each one of you. And can I just offer this lovely moment to you? Thank you. I think it was a fantastically moderated session. Really, you could get the best views out of all of them in such a short time. I'll just...
Got our best shot. Thank you very much once again to our panelists.